a war between death and life. And there on a tree, the Lamb of God was crucified.
Good morning. I am just going to take a second to see you. It's been a while. Yeah. Welcome. Thank you for being here this morning. If you're out in the lobby and you can hear me, come on in. We're going to get started. It's a good day to be in the presence of the Lord. I am just struck in the last couple of weeks with how easy it is for me to get ahead of myself and get on to what's going on tomorrow and the next day and next week and next month and so on, and I forget that the Lord is right here, right now. And he is not calling us into tomorrow. He's not calling us into next week. He's calling us into right now. And he just wants us to be with him right here, right now. And that's enough. I'm going to just encourage myself and encourage you. Let's just take a long, deep breath, because what is going to happen later is still going to be there when we're done today. and what's going to happen tomorrow is still going to be there. Let's be in the presence of the Lord and in the presence of one another right here, right now, today. So let's stand, and I'm going to pray over us. And we will begin with some songs of praise. God, we rest in your presence this morning. You were here When we entered, you will go with us when we leave. You are the ever-present God. And we are grateful for your desire to be near your children. So, Father, may we take a deep breath in, and may you fill us with your Spirit, and may our exhale be praise and worship to you. Calm our minds and our hearts, our spirits, for the things that can wait. And may we be fully present with you here today in this moment. Thank you, God, for brothers and sisters that we can gather with and be encouraged by and hear laughter and share stories and hugs and handshakes. Thank you, God, for church. God, may this church, may these people, may I be your hands and feet. And may your kingdom spread throughout Vancouver, throughout Washington, the United States, because the people at Van Church said we are going to be with our God, and our God is with us, and we have a message of hope. Thank you, Jesus. Our brother who died on the cross for us, gave us joy and peace and hope and salvation. And so we sing, we praise, we worship, we glorify you, God, for you are worthy of our praise. And we pray all of this in the name of Jesus, and together the church said, amen. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Sing aloud to God, let the people shout before his throne. Hallelujah, sing aloud to God, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Oh, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. From the ends of the earth, from the depths of the sea, let all creation praise his name. From the ends of the earth, from the depths of the sea, let all creation praise his name. So shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto the Lord. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found.
Dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. Sing, this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Amen. Be seated. Anybody know who wrote that song? I'm not sure we can call ourselves Church of Christ people. Anybody know? Lady named Fanny Crosby. Oh, almost had it. Okay, now that I've given you that answer, anybody know what was special about Fanny Crosby? She couldn't see. She was blind. I say all of that to say this. Someone who was blind writes the lyric, perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. She couldn't see, but she could see. And it makes me wonder, what do we miss right here? When we bring in burdens from the week, or we bring in our preference for how we think things should go in this room, or a broken relationship, what do we miss? We can all see, some of us better than others, but we can see, we can hear, we can feel. And yet, when we're gathered in this place together, how much do we miss what God wants to show to us? Are we really seeing? Are we seeing those moments where visions of rapture can burst on our sight, where pure joy can be heard in our ears, and we can feel compassion from our brothers and sisters? This is a special place, and this is a special time. And so as we come around the table and have our communion meal, I want us to just be aware of the room we're in and the people that we're with. And maybe ask God, God, what do you want me to see or hear or feel today? What do you have for me that I wasn't expecting? Because maybe I come in and I am blind or I'm deaf or I'm not willing to feel. What do you have for me today? Let's pray. God, you have given everything and you continue to give. God, we so often want to handle our own affairs under our own strength and in our own control. And you are just waiting and leaning in and saying, please, I'm right here. The God of the universe is right here. And you displayed that on the cross. Forgive us when we forget, when we don't see Jesus. When living out this life that we've been called into sometimes feels like it is rote or just habit, forgive us. Forgive us when we don't see Jesus. God, what do you have for us this morning? What do you have for each one of us? What do you want us to see or hear so that we may be transformed and we may transform those around us? Through the blood of your Son, Jesus, who we lift up and say thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice. In his name, amen.
Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name, Master, Savior, Jesus. Like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim, kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus. Like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Kings and kings.
Good morning, friends. Have you ever forgotten the words to something? Some people are unskilled at telling jokes. Maybe this is you. You start the joke and then you forget how it's supposed to go. So there were three men that went in to get a drink, and it was four. There were two, and one of them was a rabbi. Where was I going with this? And the people listening to you are thinking, this joke can't end fast enough. Or maybe you're laughing so hard at your own joke that you can't even finish it. I know I'm talking about some of you. Don't nudge your spouse. That's not nice. Or maybe you forget the words to a song. That's happened to me before when I've been leading worship. Blessed be your name on a road marked with suffering. Blessed be your name, right? Or have you ever seen somebody, they're singing the national anthem at a big event and they forget the words? Isn't that just mortifying? You don't know whether or not you should feel bad for them or for everyone else. It's both at the same time. And the rocket's red, the air, right? Knowing the right words matters. And listen, I know that we all have memory lapses from time to time. Everybody has that happen. But then there are moments in our lives that are so important that we either know what to say or we don't. And I'm not talking about memorized lines or song lyrics. I'm talking about something deeper, something that's more like wisdom. Maybe you know someone who, in every situation, it seems like they always know the right thing to say. Maybe they are so dialed in to what is going on, what is happening in the lives of the people around them, that they know just how to respond in every situation. They haven't forgotten the words. They know how to respond in a way that matters, to say what matters. We're in this teaching series called Beautiful People. And we're talking about how we can be part of the process of people discovering who Jesus is. Do you ever feel like, when it comes to sharing with others about Jesus and who he is and how he wants to restore our lives, do you ever feel a little bit like someone who has forgotten the words? Maybe you want to be just like those wise people that you know in your life, who know exactly the right thing to say at the right moment in every situation, but a lot of the time you find yourself messing up the punchline. You are not alone. In fact, I dare say that almost every single one of us worries about saying the right thing. But I want to challenge us today with this idea. You don't have to memorize the lines for a story that you are living out. You don't have to memorize the lines to tell a story that you are living out, because you know the story, because you're living the story, because it's real to you. It's your story. This is my story. This is my song. And I can tell that story not only with accuracy, but with authenticity. Telling the gospel story is really about living that story out. If you're living that story out, you are going to know how to talk about what that story is and what it means. When we're living out the gospel story in our lives, we will be able to help others see how that story can impact their life as well. I want us to see how Paul did this, because Paul was so obsessed with living like Jesus that he couldn't help but try to connect others, as many people as possible, to the story of Jesus and how it could change everything for them. Not just them individually, but how Jesus was changing everything on the cosmic level, how Jesus was going to restore all of creation and put everything back together again. One of the best examples of how Paul shares the story is when Paul is visiting the city of Athens in Greece. As far as we know, Paul had never been to this city before. And so let's listen as we read from Acts chapter 17, starting in verse 16. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to debate with him. Some of them asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" Others remarked, "He seems to be advocating foreign gods." They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we would like to know what they mean." All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, for he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, "We want to hear you again on this subject." At that, Paul left the council. Some of the people became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others. Let's unpack this story and identify some of the things going on here. Paul starts by affirming their desire to be religious. He doesn't say, "You're just a bunch of ungodly heathens," although they were. He understands that people are searching for meaning and significance in the world and in their lives. And he observes the way that the Athenians are searching for this significance, and he affirms them in that. Next, he identifies how their search for meaning connects with the God revealed in Jesus. He says, look, you've got this angst here because you've got this statue to an unknown God because you're worried that you're going to make one of the gods angry, and you just want to make sure that you've been thorough and that you're not leaving any of the gods out. So let me tell you about a God who isn't like that at all. And this is going to be really good news. And then he describes God in a way that all of them can connect with. He starts on common ground. He doesn't mention Abraham, Isaac, or Jacob, or the Torah, or Moses, because these are Greek people. They've never heard those stories. They don't know who those people are. He says this God created everything and everyone. He gives life to everything and everyone. He brought all nations out of one. It's like Paul is saying, look, we aren't all that far apart, you and I. We aren't all that different after all. We're all connected. And then he connects who God is with this searching and longing that we all have. God did this so that we would seek him and reach out for him and find him. That's what Paul says. And then he affirms again, God isn't far away from any of us. Do you see what Paul is doing? He is starting where they are. Where they are, not where Paul wishes that they would be. He's starting with their story, with concepts that they understand. He even quotes two voices from their own story, their own culture. In verse 28, he says, "For in him we live and move and have our being," he's quoting the Sicilian philosopher Epimenides. And then in the next line, he quotes the philosopher Aratus, who wrote about the divine, saying, "We are his offspring." And then he draws a very clear line showing how the God revealed in Jesus is the greatest fulfillment of all of the concepts that they value the most. He doesn't try to rip apart their worldview or shame them under the table or argue them around or give them convincing scientific proofs or show them where Noah's Ark landed on that there's proof and we found wheels at the bottom of the chariot wheels at the bottom of the Red Sea. He doesn't say any of that. He doesn't try to convince. He doesn't try to do what we would call apologetics. What he does is he affirms what they value. And he shows how God is the creator and the fulfiller of all of that. And did you notice that he leaves out something that we would consider to be maybe the most important thing about the gospel? Did you notice that he left something pretty significant out when he talks about the gospel to the Athenians? What did he leave out? The cross. He doesn't talk about the cross at all. Did you notice that? That's crazy. You know why? It's not because Paul thinks the cross is unimportant. Because in fact, you can read things that Paul writes throughout the New Testament. In fact, Paul says, look, there's only one thing that's important to me. Christ and him crucified, right? He says, that's the most, I'm not gonna claim to know anything else except for that. So it's not that Paul doesn't think that the cross is important. It's not that he's trying to just leave something. It's not that he forgot. I think it's because he knows they can't handle that part yet. And that might make us nervous that Paul is selectively presenting the gospel story and leaving certain things out because he knows they're not ready for it yet. Instead of barreling in like a bull in a china shop, Paul is being careful and strategic in what he shares based on who his audience is. Jesus being the sacrificial Lamb of God, the Passover Lamb who takes away the sins of the world. Paul doesn't talk about that to the Greeks because that's the Jewish story of who Jesus is. They wouldn't understand. And you also know why he doesn't mention it here. It's because they wouldn't care. That sounds harsh, but they wouldn't. They wouldn't care that Jesus takes away sins. They weren't really concerned with sins all that much. This is Athens for crying out loud. You've heard the stories of what Greek culture was like. If Paul had presented the gospel in the way that we would expect him to, if he would have presented the gospel the way that Peter preached his gospel sermon at Pentecost to a group of mostly Jewish people who already knew the story, who had heard the stories from the Old Testament, that knew who God was, they were God-fearing people, if he had presented the gospel in that way, he would have been answering a lot of questions that none of his audience were asking at all. Instead, he focuses on the resurrection. And guess what? They are intrigued. They want to know more. This reemphasizes something that we talked about last week, that we don't have to close the deal in every conversation that we have with someone about who Jesus is. We don't have to take them from a 4 out of 10 all the way to 10 in one single conversation. Paul plants a seed here so that he can keep the conversation open and continuing, even though it meant that he didn't tell them everything up front. And it says that a few people actually did end up spending more time with Paul and they eventually became followers of Jesus. It's a process, not a single conversation, even for Paul. Paul doesn't know how long he's going to be there. He's waiting for some people. And when they get there, he's going to leave Athens. He doesn't know if he's got a week or 2 weeks or 6 months or 3 years. He's not sure. He just leaves that up to God. He plants seeds and he's patient. He plays the long game because he knows that these people, they're not going to be able to go from 2 to 10 in one teaching. And so Paul prayerfully and strategically unfolds the truth in phases. And think about these results. This isn't 3,000 people coming to Jesus on Pentecost, is it? It mentions two people by name and a few others, right? We're talking about half a dozen people. And then Paul leaves. And we don't know that he ever goes back to Athens or spends very much time there. I'm saying this because what Paul was doing, the way that Paul was teaching the gospel, it wasn't converting massive crowds of people. You know, we read the letter to the Corinthians and we think, well, maybe there's got to be hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of Christians in Corinth. And maybe not. Some historians believe it might have just been two or three or four dozen people, less than 50. And they get two letters, two long letters in the New Testament. The Roman church at the time that that letter is written may not be bigger than a couple of hundred people. And for the size of city that was, that's nothing. Paul isn't obsessed with massive crowds and numbers of people. All he needs is for a few people to really, really get it. And it plants seeds that over generations flourish and the gospel spreads. And the gospel goes from being this grassroots movement of mustard seed interactions to this tidal wave of cultural and global change. I think about this a lot. I wonder if Paul was discouraged about numbers. Ministers get discouraged about numbers, if you didn't know that. I wonder if he felt like, in many ways, that he was a failure. Do you ever wonder if Paul thought, I could preach Peter under the table? I'm wondering if Paul ever thought that pridefully in his heart. Not that he ever would have ever told anybody. I can preach Peter under the table, and when I preach, I get like two or three people. And when Peter preaches, he preaches the first sermon and he gets 3,000 people. That's not fair. And then Peter hangs out the rest of his life pretty much in Jerusalem, although he went to Rome later, but he hangs out in Jerusalem most of the time. Paul's going all over the world, busting his rear, trying to convert people to 6, 12, 18, 20 people. That's it. And then he moves on. And then he's got to spend the rest of his life writing these people letters because they're just all so jacked up, right? His letters half the time are like, you are the body of Christ. You are the representation of the divine. And then the other half of the time he's saying, if you people could just stop being freaks for 2 seconds. That's the whole rest of the Bible is Paul trying to help these little churches live into this gospel story. What we do in our generation may feel small, but in God's story, even tiny seeds can grow into a big kingdom. And so as we think about how we hope the good news about Jesus will impact the lives of the people that we know, what do we take away from these observations from this story in Acts chapter 17? Here are some key takeaways. First, Paul knew their cultural story. He was fluent in it. He understood the underlying values. Listen, he didn't have a phone to do a Google search. What do Greek philosophers say about the image of God being in all people? So that he could look up those philosopher quotes before he goes in to present before the Areopagus. He doesn't do that. He just knows their story. He was familiar with the prominent voices that had shaped these people. He also knew some of the landmines that would keep them from really hearing the good news and what it was all about. And so if we are going to be in our generation, if we are going to share the good news with our friends and our neighbors and our coworkers and our family members, we need to know what the underlying narratives are in their life that have shaped their story and their culture. Our culture. We need to be familiar with the stories that are shaping us, stories of individualism, of humanistic optimism, stories about what success is and what the good life consists of. We also need to know what the roadblocks are, that many people believe that religion is bad for the world, that Christians have come across as too political or too judgmental, that scripture isn't inspired and a reliable account of what's real and true. The more fluent we are in these cultural narratives and the more familiar we are with these roadblocks, the more we will be able to speak authentically to people where they are, to interact with them in a way that doesn't step on a huge landmine and blow up in their face and in our face. And that brings us to our second takeaway. Paul starts where they are, as we've already mentioned. And he tells them that God is near to them, where they are. Isn't that interesting? Did any of you ever hear a gospel strategy that its sole purpose was to convince the other person that they were evil, that they were rotten to the core, and that they were separated from God as a result? And that's why then, now we can present the good news about Jesus. Jesus is the solution to that. But the whole first part of the conversation is aimed at convincing the other person how rotten they are. And Paul doesn't do that. He starts where they are and he says, God is near to you. That's extraordinary. He connects with them at a place that they hold in common instead of engaging them on a front where they disagree and where he's going to have to try to convince them. Listen, it doesn't say that Paul never argued with anybody. In fact, it says that he was in the marketplace all the time, and these philosophers are arguing with him, and he's talking right back. It's not that he's avoiding arguments. It's that he knows when to argue, and he knows where to start, it seems. We've got to start where people are. Third, and possibly most important, Paul knew not just the cultural story, but Paul knew the gospel story and how it connected with the cultural story. This is huge. Did you notice how very little of what Paul said sounded like the typical American evangelical version of the gospel presentation? That Jesus Christ came to earth to die on the cross to save you from your sins so that you can go to heaven when you die, or some variation of that. It's not that there's anything necessarily untrue about that statement or that it completely misses the mark. It's just that the gospel is so much bigger and better than just that. The gospel is better than that. Jesus didn't just come just to save me from my sin so that I can go to heaven when I die. Have you noticed the individual nature of that, the American individualistic nature of that statement that we present as gospel? It's not just that Jesus comes to rescue me, it's Jesus comes to save the whole world. And not just to deal with our sins, my sin and your sin, but to collectively and corporately and globally and cosmically deal with evil and to destroy it once and for all. For Jesus wants to turn the world upside down and inaugurate a new kingdom, a new creation of life where all are one with God and with each other. This is about everything. So it's time for some honesty. Is it possible that the American church is so poor at evangelism because it doesn't really understand what the good news is? And if the church in America overall doesn't really know what the good news is, then how can we speak of it in a meaningful way to our friends and neighbors? The fundamental point of this series is that we as a people, together, must embody the good news. If our friends and our neighbors are going to discover who Jesus is, it is because they will see the good news of the gospel on display in us as people. If they are going to believe that a new creation is emerging because of Jesus Christ, then they're going to have to see some proof in people who are being shaped by following Jesus together. So if we are going to live out the gospel, then we have to know what it is. And guess how we come to know what the gospel is? Here's where I start to sound like a really old school preacher here. You want to know how we come to understand and know what the gospel is? We immerse ourselves in the gospel story together. That's how. Translation, in case I'm not being clear, that means that we are together. As often as we can manage it, we are together. We are studying the story together. We are learning about who Jesus is together. We are immersing our lives and our hearts and our worldviews and our perspectives in the Jesus story together. We are gathering around the table of Jesus together. We spend time together. We worship together. We pray together. We serve together. We participate. We show up. We travel together and do life with each other. And if we don't do these things together, then we won't immerse ourselves in the story of Jesus together. And if that doesn't happen, then we won't really know what the gospel is all about. The question for us to wrestle with today is not, do we have a hold of the gospel? But does the gospel have a hold of us? Are you captivated by the story of Jesus and of the kingdom of God? Are you allowing his dream for the world to draw you into a deep community and transformation? How many of you have ever been to a large event and someone started the wave? Have you ever been to something and someone did the wave? You've seen this before? Two of you? Okay, good. Who would have thought that doing this, hey, with 50,000 other people would be so much fun? How does the wave actually start? One crazy, insane person. Right? One insane person who's sitting there watching the Mariners beat the Texas Rangers. And they're sitting there eating their peanuts, drinking their soda. They say, you know what? You know what's missing in this whole experience is a bunch of people doing this. Hey, together. That's what's missing. I'm going to do that. And so they stand up. And they go, hey, and people look at them, and some people who have experienced this before are thinking, I hate my life right now, and I hate you, right? That's what they're thinking when you do that in that moment. This crazy person starts doing the wave. They are alone. They are insane. And sometimes they try to get the wave started for an embarrassing amount of time. Something has to happen, though, before the wave can start. That one person has to convince a few other people to be crazy with them, to join them. And let's acknowledge that these first responders, these early adopters, are very brave people to join this event at this stage, because this thing hasn't really taken off yet. And they're making a choice to join the leader. And so now maybe you got 5 or 10 people doing this together, you know, hey, and they watch and nobody else does it, but they keep doing it. And maybe now one other person in the next section over, they hear the noise and they look over and they see it and they wait. And then the 5 or 10 people who started, hey, and then one other person, hey, and everybody's like, yeah, there's our friend over there. You've experienced this, right? And then a few more people, and then a few more people. But as the group gets larger and louder, more people notice. And eventually, you get almost an entire section standing up and doing this ridiculous thing. And then the next section, and it may start to make its way around the stadium a little bit, and then it fizzles out, and everybody's like, ah, come on. And there's always that one section that won't participate, and everybody's like, what's wrong with those people? It's not even about peer pressure, because let's be honest, no one can make anybody else stand up and do this thing, right? People choose to join this adventure because it's a delight. And over time, this thing catches on. And when it does, it's amazing. And eventually, what you get is something so huge and so delightful and silly and joyful that almost everyone finds participating a compelling option. Sure, there are a few stubborn holdouts who have a bad attitude and probably hate Christmas too. But we're not worried about them because now we're all part of something really special. And as silly as that all sounds, the gospel is kind of like that. Jesus comes into the world, one man, and he is living a life like no other, and he is living out a new reality, a new kingdom, a new creation. And some people who see who Jesus is think that he is insane by what he is saying and what he is doing. But some, and actually not just some, but some people, they are compelled. They see what Jesus is doing and they hear what he is saying and they think it's beautiful. They see how he is living and they want to start to try to mimic what he is doing, to learn to do what he's doing. And they start to join with him in rhythm. And then this group of people starts to live like Jesus. And the world around this small band, this little community, the world around them begins to notice. And they find it compelling as well. And so more join in, and then more, and then more. And all of a sudden, you don't just have one. You don't just have three. You don't just have 12. You don't just have 72 or 120 or 500 or 3,000. Now all of a sudden, you've got a movement, a kingdom movement. And this thing begins to spread like wildfire. And it's not a religion, it's a people. And so here it comes. And now it's your turn, it's our turn. Don't be that section of the crowd, of the story that fails to live up to living out the story. Others have come before us. And as ridiculous as they might seem to us now for the mistakes that they made and the things that they didn't get that now we just see so clearly, as ridiculous as they may have seemed now, here it comes. Here comes the story, and it's our turn. Sure, there will be many around us that don't find what we're doing compelling and they refuse to be part of this thing. Some will not find it compelling at all, and others will see it as ridiculous. But you and me, we've encountered Jesus. And we know that he's not crazy because he has the words of life and he has changed us. And we've experienced resurrection, not just something that's gonna happen later. We've experienced new life now and a taste of the fullness of life everlasting. And we are captivated by him. And so the best thing that we can do now is to do this thing together with all the joy and passion that we can muster so that those around us who come after us might take up the call as well. It's not our job to single-handedly argue people into participating. That's no fun anyways, is it? You think God's happy when somebody's like, oh, all right, I'm not happy about it, but I'll come because my friend forced me to through peer pressure. Our job is to spread the joy, to be the beautiful people so that the world will see that God is good. And so may you be captivated by the story. May you become fluent in all of the narratives that are shaping the lives of the people around you that you love, that you care about, that friend that you are praying about, that you want more than anything for their good. You want to see them thrive. You want their life to be changed. You want them to come to know who Jesus is. May you pay attention. May you learn to speak to them where they are. Be fluent in the stories around you so that we can speak clearly and not forget the words when it matters most. And may those around you, around us, hear the good news and see that God is good. Let those who have ears to hear, hear the word of God. Let's sing together.
Stand with me if you would.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me beneath the healing, cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that thou art with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him more and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
It's been good to be with you today. I'm so grateful for this church family and for the way that we love each other and we encourage each other. I've seen the love of God in you and experienced that together with you this morning around God's table. I want to remind you that we practice the spiritual discipline of giving and giving sacrificially of our time and also of our resources. And so we have a box at the back table where you got your communion elements. It's our giving box. Yes. And I think we could do better, right? So we've been talking about the wave. That was a little bit, that's right. We're not going to do the wave in here. I refuse to be known as the preacher who made us do the wave, okay? But there is a box back there, and it is an opportunity for us to give. You can also go online to our website, vanchurch.org, and give there as well. And you can, of course, always mail in an offering as well to the church office. Thank you for the ways that you participate in that and that we do that together as a church family. And now may the boldness of the resurrected Jesus, who holds the keys of death and life, who is the beginning and end, the firstborn over all creation. He is the image of the invisible God, the full representation of God's being. May his power animate your spirit and fill your heart with courage so that you may speak boldly and appropriately and lovingly to the people around you. May the Holy Spirit remind you that you are not in this alone, that together we are the good news, that Jesus changes lives. And may you go into this week and into the lives of the people around you, and may you be salt and light, that they may see God's goodness. Go in peace. We're dismissed.